Good afternoon and welcome to all of you to this session of conduction and convection heat transfer. Today I will discuss the exact solutions of Navier-Stokes equations. So last few classes Professor Suman Chakraborty derived the Navier-Stokes equation, which is basically the equation of motion for the flow of a viscous fluid. And you have already recognized that the Navier-Stokes equation is a nonlinear second order partial differential equation. If I just write the Navier-Stokes equation again in vector form, let me write the Navier-Stokes equation in a vector form. If you recollect, let us consider this in an incompressible flow, Navier-Stokes, NS equation incompressible flow. For a simple case, for our understanding, we just exclude the term for compressible flow, incompressible flow. Then the Navier-Stokes equation stands like this in the vector form. I am writing in a vector form, minus grad p plus mu Laplacian of the velocity vector, del square. Now this is the inertial term. These are all per unit volume. This is acceleration. This is the pressure term, pressure force per unit volume. This is the viscous force. Now this can be splitted, this acceleration part, in terms of its temporal acceleration plus v dot. This already I think Professor Suman Chakraborty has told you, and this part remains as it is. Now here it is easy to recognize. First of all, this is a, again I am repeating the thing, this is a partial differential equation, because the velocity, which is the dependent variable, is a function of space coordinates and time. Now the, in this acceleration part of the inertial term, the advection terms are the nonlinear terms, v dot grad v. V dot grad is an operator, acts on v, vector v. And this gives rise to the nonlinear terms. This term is the linear term, del square v, Laplacian, but this contains the second order term. Because of this nonlinearity in the inertial term, even for a steady flow, this may be 0, but convective term will not be 0. There is no exact analytical solution in closed form for Navier-Stokes equations for all purposes of fluid flow. But there are certain classes of fluid flow where we have exact solutions. We have exact solutions when the inertial term identically vanishes. All the terms vanish. And those situations pertain to a simple linear equations, which is amenable to solution, analytical solutions. And those, these cases are known as exact solutions. Those cases are known as exact. And those cases of flows where the inertial term identically vanishes, becomes zero, and Navier-Stokes equation becomes a linear equation, and we can have its analytical solution in closed form and known as exact solution. And these cases, in very short I tell you, pertain to this type of flow. Steady, laminar, steady, laminar, incompressible, fully developed flow. Now each and every term I think is known to you. steady flow you already know from your fluid mechanics knowledge. Laminar flow is also known. What is the problem here? Okay, laminar flow is also known. What is a laminar flow? If time permits, I think either myself or Professor Suman Chakraborty will give you a brief idea about the laminar and turbulent flow, which you have already covered in your fluid mechanics class. Similarly, the incompressible flow and the fully developed flow. This fully developed flow only I will describe today, which will be again described afterwards when we will discuss the boundary layer theory. What is a fully developed flow? Probably all these things are known to you, and I hope that fully developed flow also is known to you in your earlier fluid mechanics class, but still I like to tell you what is a fully developed flow. This you have to understand better, because these things are much easier in compared to understanding of fully developed flow. Fully developed flow is like this. If we consider, let us consider the flow through a channel comprising two fixed plates. Let us consider a channel, this is the axis. And let us consider a uniform velocity, a flow with a uniform velocity, a flow with a uniform velocity of u infinity, for example, or uo, u0, approaches this channel made by two fixed plates. Then what will happen? The boundary layer will grow from the leading edge. Like this, from the two surfaces, and they will eventually merge at the axis. The boundary layer will grow. The concept of boundary layer, I told that within which the velocity gradient will exist. That means the viscous action of the fluid will be restricted within the boundary layer because of the diffusion of momentum. This is the consequence of the interaction between the fluid and the solid surface, aided by the or interfered by the fluid property viscosity. That already I told this concept while discussing the introduction to convection. So if it is so that the boundary layer grows like this, then one will expect a velocity distribution like this at the section very close to the inlet. Let this section is 1. He will expect a velocity distribution like this. That means there will be a variation of velocity from both sides from 0. This is the no slip condition. That means the surface is at rest, so fluid velocity will be 0. And beyond the boundary layer, the fluid velocity will be constant. There will be no variation of fluid velocity in the y direction. Let us, this is the y and this is x. This direction is x. So therefore, at this section we see very close to the plate there is a region that is known as boundary layer, which will be told afterwards, where the viscous effect is there, the velocity gradient is there. Beyond which there is no viscous effect, since the velocity is like this one, inlet velocity is uniform in the y direction. Now, as the boundary layer grows in the direction of flow, at another section downstream, if you plot the velocity distribution, you will see it is very simple to understand that ultimately this is known as potential core, and this is known as boundary layer region. Potential core or potential region, where the velocity is uniform and there is no shear stress. Now this potential core or the potential region is reduced, and ultimately it will be reduced to 0. But the interesting fact is that the center line velocity is increased for a steady incompressible flow. Why? That means if here we consider the center line velocity for section 1 is uc1, and this center line velocity is uc2, that means this center line velocity. Center line means the potential core velocity, velocity in the potential region. Then uc2 is greater than uc1, that means the potential core is accelerated. Potential core, the velocity is increasing. Why? Very simple. For a steady incompressible flow, the volume flow rate at each section is constant. And the volume flow rate at a section can be written as area into average velocity. Now at the inlet, if we write, it will be A into U0, that is the uniform velocity. At any other section, it will be A into U average. So therefore, you see U average in this case is equal to U0. That means U average is U0. That means at each and every section, U average is constant because of the constant volume flow rate. Since area is constant, the average velocity is constant and equals to the U0, that is the inlet velocity. Since more is the boundary layer as the flow proceeds along its direction in the downstream, that means more fluid is slowed down because of the viscous effect and the solid wall interactions, the central line or the central region velocity, that is the potential core or potential region velocity, has to increase to make the same average velocity, because the potential core, that uniform velocity, is getting reduced. That means fluid is retarded more in the direction transverse to the channel. So to have a constant average velocity, this velocity has to increase. And finally, what will happen, you see that, after the boundary layer merges, we will have a velocity profile like this. We will have a velocity profile like this. And here you see difference is that here the velocity profile, the shape is changing, and at each section there is viscous zone and the potential zone. But when this merges, there is no potential zone. Entire zone is the viscous zone, and the center line velocity, which is the maximum velocity that is reached, that is the potential core velocity. And U here in this region, U is a function of X and Y. It is obvious U is a function of X and Y. If you see at any X, U is a function of Y. And at any Y, U is a function of X. Because at fixed any Y, here the flow is in the potential core. But if you go along the flow direction, this will be within the retarded boundary layer. So therefore, U is both a function of X and Y, but when this, U is a function of Y only, U is not a function of X. When the two boundary layer merges, the velocity takes a fully developed shape, the entire region is the viscous region, and the velocity becomes only a function of Y, and as you go along the downstream direction, it resembles the same velocity, which is varying with the Y. There is no change in the velocity, same distribution with X. That means at any Y, the velocity remains the same with X. This comes from the similarity of the boundary layer, similarity velocity profile of the boundary layer. I tell you that this part which I have told you today, it will be difficult to be appreciated wholly until and unless you know the boundary layer correctly. I don't know whether you have done it explicitly at your fluid mechanics class. If you have done it earlier, then you know, because of the similarity in the velocity profile within the boundary layer, we have this type of distribution. So within the boundary layer, we can express the velocity profile as a function of a similarity parameter. Okay, that will be discussed afterwards, but now you know this thing, that after this region, when the two boundary layer merges, we get a profile like this. Now, beyond this region, flow is known as fully developed flow. Fully developed flow. Fully developed flow. And this region of flow, well, where the boundary layer grows, and yet it is boundary layer grows and yet to merge, this region is known as developing region. developing flow or entrance region. This is a consequence of the boundary layer and its growth, which will be taught afterwards. This is known as entrance region. That means when flow is fully developed, we have a similarity velocity profile. That means the velocity profile is a function of only the transverse coordinate. Here y is not the function of x. That means the space coordinates along which the flow takes place. This is the concept of fully developed flow. Now, with this concept, we will make an exact solution of a particular type of flow known as quiet flow. What is a quiet flow? Quiet flow is a steady, I am not writing it again on the board, incompressible, laminar and fully developed flow. This is common for all exact solution cases. There are different cases, but in all cases, flow depicts this feature. But quiet flow, each and every flow has a different flow geometry. Quiet flow is the flow between two plates. Quiet flow is the flow between two plates. Let us consider these two plates. Say, chalks are rubbish. Let us have two plates. And there is a steady, incompressible, laminar and fully developed flow. And let us have the distance between the plate as h. And one plate, let us consider the upper plate, is moving with a velocity u infinity with relative to the lower plate, which means let us consider the lower plate is fixed, that u 0, whereas upper plate has a velocity u infinity. That means here the flow is initiated or driven by the shear. That means the motion of the plate drags the entire fluid in the channel to flow. But along with that, we can impose a pressure gradient also. That means there is a high pressure this side, low pressure this side. That means it will be also aided by the pressure gradient, that is known as pressure driven flow. That means if I consider this as x direction and this as y direction, I can consider the flow to be also driven by the pressure gradient. And this pressure gradient may be negative or positive. Negative pressure gradient means the pressure upstream is more than the downstream, it decreases in the direction of flow. That is known as negative pressure gradient. Pressure decreases in the positive direction of x, the direction of flow. That is a favorable pressure gradient because this pressure gradient favors the flow in this direction. Pressure may be opposing. That means adverse pressure gradient, dp dx is greater than 0. That means the pressure downstream is more than the upstream. In that case, the pressure or the pressure force on a fluid element opposes the flow in this direction, in the negative direction, relative to the drag of the plate or shear of the plate. There is a tug of war between the two. That will be manifested in the mathematical equations. So let us consider in general a flow between two plates, one of which is moving with u infinity respect to other, a constant velocity, and drives the fluid by shear, along with a imposed pressure gradient. That means it is both a shear driven and pressure driven flow. Now come to the Navier-Stokes equation, which I wrote there. Now if you write the Navier-Stokes equation in Cartesian coordinate, and at the same time you consider the z the breadth or width of the channel in this direction is much larger than this channel height. So with this in consideration, you first start writing all the equation. Now, first of all, if the fluid is incompressible, this is a very important concept, I tell you. Many people, even at a later stage, lacks this concept. Please listen to it, that for an incompressible flow, one can tell that basic requirement or definition of an incompressible flow is that dv/dt, that means the rate of change of volume with respect to time, that volumetric dilation, or the density, if you divided it by 1 by V, then equality holds good. With a negative sign only, because rho V is constant for any fluid element. Consider it as a system equals to 0. I think in fluid mechanics you have learned this. And these two terms equal to divergence of the velocity vector, this has been proved in the kinematics, is equal to 1 upon rho, that means the substantial derivative of density equals to the substantial derivative of volume, and that 1 by V, this equals to divergence of the velocity vector. Again, I tell you, this is the rate of change of volumetric dilation per unit volume. It is the rate of change of density per unit volume. And this equals to divergence of V, and this becomes zero. Therefore, for an incompressible flow, divergence of velocity vector zero comes from its basic definition of incompressibility. It is nothing to do with continuity. Many people tell that it is consequence of continuity. No. Continuity equation is automatically satisfied. Sometimes many teachers teach wrongly. This is by definition, this has been discussed, that rate of volumetric dilation is zero by definition. The rate of change of density is zero, and that becomes equal to divergence of velocity vector, which comes from the kinematics. Now let us write the continuity equation. Now continuity equation, if you write here, continuity. Let us consider the Cartesian coordinate, continuity. I know the continuity is del rho del t plus, in a Cartesian coordinate system, del del x of rho u, or rather I will write in vector form, which will be valid for all coordinate system. Divergence of rho v, I think you know this thing, is zero. So if I now expand this divergence of rho v, v being a vector, then this will be v dot grad of rho plus rho into divergence of velocity vector. Now these two is the substantial derivative of density, del rho del t plus v dot grad rho. In Cartesian coordinate, v dot grad rho will be what? U del rho del x plus v del rho del y plus w del rho del z, where u, v, w are the x, y and z component of velocity. That means this becomes d rho dt plus rho of divergence of velocity vector, that equals to 0. That means it automatically satisfies the continuity, because d rho dt is 0 and divergence of velocity vector is also 0, because this is implicitly connected with this d rho dt through this. It is clear? So therefore one should understand that the essence of the essence of the incompressible flow is the divergence of velocity vector zero doesn't come from the continuity, but it is by the fundamental definition of incompressibility, and continuity automatically is satisfied in that case, the continuity equation for an incompressible flow. Okay. Now, if we accept this for an incompressible flow, continuity equation, by definition, you get del u del x plus del v del y plus del W del Z is 0. Now here, because of the geometry that Z is so large, any change in the Z direction we neglect. And moreover, this flow does not have any W component. So therefore, this becomes 0. Now for a fully developed flow, del U del X is 0. So therefore, consequence of this is del V del Y is 0. Del V del Y is 0. And this del V del Y is 0, since there is a plate at 0 velocity in the field, if you apply this condition, you will be able to find that the y direction velocity is 0 for this plate also, any of the plate. Two plates are non-penetrating, impermeable plate. So if you apply this equation either to this plate or this plate, del V del Y 0, so you will get a velocity in the next point 0. So therefore, if you go on, this is the understanding, you will see that all the points will be 0. That means in a flow field, the two points, because of the two plates which do not allow any penetration, impermeable plates, that means mathematically, since V is equal to 0 at both Y0 and YH, V is 0 throughout. So therefore, incompressibility condition gives us that Y component of velocity is 0. That means this type of flow, a coed flow, is only having a U component of flow, which is not a function of X, which is a function of Y. Now let us write the Navier-Stokes equation. Navier-Stokes equation in each direction. Now let me write first the X direction. That is the vector from del U del T plus, now this V dot grad operator with the vector V. If I put it U here, then V dot grad U will be U del U del X plus V del U del Y plus W del U del Z, I write in the full form, is equal to minus del P del X plus mu del square U del X square plus del square U del Y square plus del square U del Z square. All right? Now I write the V direction equation, rho del V del T plus U del V del X plus V del V del Y plus W del V del Z is equal to minus del P del Y plus mu. I write the full form first. We consider everything is there, no term is 0, del square V del Z square. And if you write the equation for the third dimension, that means with W component, then I write del W del T plus similarly the convective term U del W del X V del W del Y plus W del W del Z, that means V dot grad W is equal to minus del P del Z plus mu del square W del X square plus del square W del Y square plus del square W del Z square. Now one by one, first this thing, there is no W. So therefore, and steady state, this equation 0. And the consequence of this equation is that del P del Z is 0, which means P is not a function of Z. P is not a function of Z. What is this equation? Here also, already I have proved that V is 0. So all derivatives of V is 0. There is no existence of V. So in the similar way, I have the conclusion from y motion, y direction motion, equation of motion of the Navier-Stokes equation, del p del y is 0. P is not a function of y. Good. So therefore you see from the two equations, y and z directions, I have this idea that p is a function of x only. Okay, if you have got any query, you can ask me. Don't ask your friends, you can ask me. Okay, p is a function of x only. So therefore, before inspecting any term, I first change this, because already I have got a result that p is a function of x only. So minus dp dx in terms of ordinary differential, dp dx, p is a function of x only. Now let us see that how all inertial terms vanish here. Steady flow, the characteristic feature. Now u is there, but del u del x 0, because the flow is fully developed. That's the beauty. And these two terms are 0 because v is non-existent and w is non-existent. So you see the inertial term are all vanishing, even in the x component of Navier-Stokes equation. So therefore, we get from what we get from the x direction motion, x direction equation of motion, that is x direction Navier-Stokes equation, all terms in the left hand side is 0. Here, this is 0. Why? Because z is so large compared to h, the variation with respect to z, and that too second order variation, whose scale is z square in the denominator. It is much smaller compared to other term. We can consider it to be 0. Del square u del x square 0, because del u del x is 0. U is not a function of x. So again, by virtue of the fully developed flow characteristics, we have this thing. Therefore, our final equation becomes d square u dy square. Since u is a function of y, that already we have proved is equal to 1 by mu dp dx. If you have anything to ask me, you ask me. Don't talk in the class continuously. I do not understand that why this is happening here. Is there any problem? Hello? Please tell. Is there any problem? Hello? Now why you people are talking, I don't know. Continuously. You ask me whatever you want to ask. So 1 by mu dp dx. So therefore we see that this is the final equation which we get from Navier-Stokes equations from in three directions for a coed flow. Coed flow thing has not yet come. That means it is a flow which is steady, incompressible, laminar, fully developed, and specified in terms of a Cartesian coordinate, where x, y, z are the coordinate system and u, v, w is the respective velocities, because so far this geometrical configuration of flow has not been imposed. So therefore, you can consider that this equation is the generalized equation for all cases of exact solutions. That means steady, again I am telling, incompressible, laminar, fully developed flow. Now, before integrating this to find out the value of u as a function of y, you appreciate one thing, u is a function of y. So d square u dy square may be either constant or a function of y, depending upon the type of the function. If it is a quadratic function, then it will be constant. But if the power of y is more than 2, then it will be a function of y. So the option is that either function of y or constant, where p is a function of x, that we have already proved. That means dp dx is either constant or a function of x. If it is a linear function of x, then it is constant. Otherwise, it will be a function of x. But when the two are equal, So the only possibility is that they become constant. So with this logic, at this state, one can tell that P is a linear function in the direction of flow in case of such situations of an laminar, incompressible, steady, fully developed flow. P has to be a linear function in the direction of flow. That means two are equally constant. Now we can integrate this. Two times we can integrate. First you integrate du dy, which is equal to 1 by mu dp dx into x, oh sorry, y plus c1, and u is equal to y square by 2, 1 by 2 mu dp dx y square plus c1 y plus c2. So up to this, I have not done anything with respect to coet flow. So this is the Cartesian coordinate velocity field for an exact solution situation. U is 1 by 2 mu dp dx y square plus c1 y plus c2. Up to this, everything is common. Now for a coet flow, now depending upon the flow geometry, I will find out c1 and c2. How to find out? What are the boundary conditions? Tell me, at y is equal to 0, u is 0. At y is 8, what is the value of u? What is the value of u? U infinity. U is equal to u infinity. Now at y is equal to 0, u is equal to 0 means c2 is equal to 0. At y is equal to 8, if you put u infinity, you get a value of c1. That is, c1 is equal to what? C1 is equal to u infinity by 8. This side will be minus, but I will write this way, 1 by 2 mu, this is the style, minus dp dx into y is h square. So this is the, these are the values of c1 and c2. And if you plot these values of c1 and c2, you get, now what happened, I don't understand, why are you talking? Is there, hello you, what happened to you? Come here. Why are you talking? I'm really sorry. What happened, can you tell me? What is that? C1 is equal to u infinity by h plus 1 by 2 mu minus dp dx into h, yes. C1, this is 1 by 2 mu h squared, c1 h is h, yes. You tell that. Sir, it will be h. Any one of you raise hand and tell, sir, it will be h. That is the way of telling, yes. Hello. Really, what is the problem? Hey, aap need to just stop kore din tota and edit kore debe. Now please tell me what is the problem. I am very sorry that this will be telecast, I will erase it, but what is your problem, you tell me. Why are you talking here? I am requesting those who are not interested may leave this class. Is there any problem for you to understand? Hello? If anybody cannot understand, you raise hand. I will be very happy to know. Then I will tell it again. I will take him to my office and I will explain things. I will be very happy. Please raise your hands. Don't feel shy. Then why are you talking continuously? I don't understand. Can you tell me the reason? Hello, you. Yes, I do not know when I will finish. But really it is very disturbing. Whenever I am teaching, there is a sound going on. That means you are all chatting here. Except very few in the first two or three rows. Am I true? Hello, you. Am I true? True or false? And nobody can tell it is false because it is known. You can ask him. Is it true? Now, what is the problem? You tell me. Yes, told sir, it will be 8. Good. If there is any mistake, you tell me. Okay. So C2 becomes 0. Take it. C2 becomes 0. And C1 is this. Now, if you put C1 and C2 in this equation, U, if you put this C1 and C2 in the U with certain rearrangement, very simple, just you put it and you get this equation, this type of expression for the velocity distribution in terms of a non-dimensional quantity like this, y by h plus h square by 2 mu u infinity. U infinity is divided both sides, that's why. This is the way, minus dp dx. It is rearrangement only. It's very simple, y by h into 1 minus y by h. And this is the equation for the velocity distribution in the quiet flow. Now, this term is represented by capital P, which is known as non-dimensional pressure gradient. Because this term is non-dimensional, y by h is non-dimensional, u by u infinity is non-dimensional. This is non-dimensional variable, so this has to be non-dimensional. So group of this h square by 2 mu u infinity into minus dp dx, that means this group which contains the pressure gradient is denoted as capital P and is known as non-dimensional pressure gradient. So if I write in terms of non-dimensional pressure gradient, expression looks little simple, that capital P y by h into 1 minus y by h. Now you see, this is a velocity distribution equation where u is a function of y or y by h as a non-dimensional y with p as the parameter. Now as a special case, when there is no P, that means P is equal to 0, that is no pressure gradient, there is no dP dx, that means capital P is 0, that means the fluid in the channel is driven only by the shear, that means it is only a shear driven flow, then this term is 0 and we get a linear velocity distribution. Here, if I draw this in this plane, this is the u by u infinity and this is y by h, then we will get a linear distribution. This is 1, that means at y is equal to h and this is also 1. We get u is equal to u infinity. That has to be there because the boundary condition has to be satisfied. That means here the velocity is u infinity. No slip condition. We get a linear one. And that is given by P is equal to 0. And this situation is known as simple or sometimes plain coed flow. That means coed flow without any pressure gradient. The flow is purely shear driven. In that case, we have a linear velocity distribution starting from 0 to the upper plate velocity or the velocity of the plate which is moving. Now, if this is the case, now we consider different values of P and see the behavior of this function. This is very, very interesting. Let me do that. You consider different values of P and let us examine the behavior of these velocity distributions. One can definitely draw the curves for different values of P, but now let me write again this equation. U by U infinity is Y by H plus P into Y by H into 1 minus Y by H. Now, to know this behavior of these velocity distributions with different P, let us do one thing. Let us first find out du dy. What is du dy? Du dy is simply 1 by H plus P by H into 1 minus 2y by h. I think there is no mistake, y square 2y by h. Okay? This is the value of du dy. Now let us find out whether this curve exhibits a maxima or minima or not. A linear curve doesn't have any maxima or minima. This is a linearly increasing, a monotonically increasing function. And the maximum value of the velocity is this one, u infinity. Now let us examine whether this curve has a maximum or minimum. Then we have to do this, it has to be made 0. For maximum or minimum, max or mean, du dy equals to 0. That means this equals to 0, which gives by a little rearrangement y by h is half plus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 2 p. Simply you put it 0 and take y by h on one side and express it in terms of non-dimensional coordinate y by h, half plus 1 by 2 p. And at the same time, I see that d square u dy square is equal to what? D square u dy square, if you make, that means it is minus 2 p by h square. To judge whether it is a maximum or minimum, very good, please. U by u infinity is y by h, du by dy, very good. I am in a mood to make it 0, that is why u infinity was missing, fantastic, u infinity. So if you make this mistake in using du dy somewhere without u infinity, some marks will be deducted, not full marks. So this is u infinity, very good. So du dy 0 means this is 0, u infinity cannot be 0. So therefore, I have this condition for maximum minimum for the value of y and d square u dy square. Now consider p greater than 0. P greater than 0 means what is p? P equals to, again I write, P equals to h square by 2 mu u infinity minus dp dx. P greater than 0 means dp dx is negative, less than 0. This is the situation known as favorable pressure gradient, which favors the flow. That means shear driven flow and the pressure driven flow are in line. In that case, if p is greater than 0, this is negative. That means we have a maximum, not minimum. Okay? Now again, there are interesting things. What are those locations where we get maximum for different values of p when p is greater than 0? Now when p greater than 0, under this heading, I split it. Let us consider p greater than 0 but less than 1. This is because of the typical relation. Now when p is less than 1, between 0 to 1, greater than 0, less than 1, y by h is greater than 1. Because this is greater than half. That means the curve mathematically has a maximum, but that maximum is beyond the flow domain. I don't have any interest. So for those values of p, my maximum velocity in the flow domain is u infinity. The curve may not show a mathematical maximum, a zero slope there, like a linear profile. Linear profile will never show any zero velocity as a constant slope. So therefore, 0 to 1 value p, the maxima will occur beyond this. That means this y by h is greater than 1. But when p is greater than 1, then y by h is less than 1. That means I have a maximum within the flow domain. That is y by h less than 1. And at the same time, if we put this value of y by h, half plus 1 by 2p, you get the value of u max or u mean. That means if you substitute this y by h in this value, in this, this equation, expression of u, you get the value u infinity into 1 plus p whole square divided by 4p. Okay? So when p greater than 1, the u max, then it is a question of maximum is greater than u infinity. This is compatible because the flow has a maximum velocity within the flow domain somewhere below the upper plate or the moving plate, which has to be higher than u infinity, then it will not be a maximum. Now let us examine a borderline case. P is equal to 1. In that case, du dy is equal to 0. Sorry. Then du dy 0 at y is equal, y by h is equal to 1. Y by h is equal to 1. That means when p is equal to 1, y by h is equal to 1. That means the maximum occurs at the surface, upper plate. That means we can draw a curve like this. This is for p equals to 1. That means which shows a maximum at the surface, because du dy 0 is y by h 1. But at the surface, boundary condition tells it is u infinity. And if you put p is equal to 1, where u max is u infinity. But when it is more than 1, that means favorable pressure gradient is more strong, which makes p more than 1, we get from this equation u max greater than u infinity. U max greater than u infinity. And these things are like this. Here it is 1, but somewhere here, let us consider, this is p is equal to 1. And if you go on increasing the p, you will see your maximum point will come close to the stationary plate. And the value of u infinity, value of u max will be increased. Clear? Hello? Okay. Now we consider the case when p is less than 0, means dp dx is greater than 0, which is known as adverse pressure gradient. Favorable pressure gradient, this is adverse. Why adverse? because DPDA is greater than zero, upstream pressure is lower than the downstream pressure. That means the pressure force acts opposite to the direction of flow. This is common fluid mechanical terminology. Now, when P less than 1, I also split like this, less than 0. Let us consider P less than 0, but greater than minus 1. That means 0 greater than P, but P greater than minus 1. Similar way, the beauty is that it is just a mirror image. When P is between 0 to minus 1, that means P is less than 0 but greater than minus 1, Y by H is less than 0. See that? Because this dominates with the negative value. So in that case, Y by H is less than 0. Y by H is less than 0. That means this is not our concern. This is not in the fluid domain. What happened in this case, that between 0 to 1, the maximum point occurs Y by H greater than 1. It is just the same way Y by H less than 0. When P is equal to minus 1, special case, then du dy 0 at Y by H 0, half plus 2P. If you put P is equal to minus 1, then it is Y by H 0. That means it occurs at the surface. That means surface is the no slip condition, zero velocity. That means if I draw the curve will show the zero with a zero slope. The line will be vertical. This is P is equal to minus 1. Now, what happens when P is less than minus 1? That means P is less than minus 1, Y by H is greater than 0. So, this is very interesting that P is less than minus 1, Y by H is greater than 0. That means we come into the flow domain, similar to the thing happened, similar to the same thing that happened for P greater than 0 cases. Then we find that Y greater than 0. That means we come to the flow domain above this stationary plate. And in this case, the value of U minimum will be given by this with a negative sign. P is less than 0 means in the opposite direction. That means the flow reversal will take place. Boundary layer separation, I think in fluid mechanics class it was told. And if you look that picture, it will be like this. Somewhere the flow will be minimum. That means in the opposite direction, this is the minimum flow. That Y by H. That means this is a particular, I draw it by this color so that, this is all bogus. This color, this is P is equal to minus 1, and this curve is for P less than minus 1. Let us consider P is equal to minus 1. This is the condition. Clear? Now, we see a flow reversal. That means a negative direction flow near the stationary plate when the adverse pressure gradient increases such a way that P is less than minus 1. So this is well known. This is physically explained. Now, let me explain this physically, that when P is 1 here maximum, then P is 2. This is P is 2. I am sorry. This is let P is 3. This was 1. This is 2, 3. The flow velocity somewhere here is more than the upper plate velocity. That means the favorable pressure gradient helps the flow along with shear. So it is shear driven or pressure driven in the same direction, which allows the fluid to flow at a velocity larger than the plate velocity. Another interesting feature is that at p is equal to 1, that means there is a value of dp dx, negative dp dx, favorable pressure gradient, at which point here the velocity gradient is 0, that means no shear stress is there. That means to drag the pressure, that is to move the plate with the velocity u infinity does not require any force. If you keep the plate, it will automatically flow. This is because the pressure gradient causing the flow keeps that velocity u infinity at that surface. You understand? That means a free surface is moving at some velocity. Because of the pressure gradient imposed on the flow, if you keep a plate, plate will automatically flow. So therefore, there is no shear stress required. And for strong pressure gradients, negative pressure gradient or favorable pressure gradient, the pressure driven flow aids the flow along with the shear driven to attain a velocity more than u infinity somewhere. Reverse is the true when the pressure gradient is adverse, that means dp dx is positive, that is p is negative, then with this value of p, when it is minus 1, here it is 0, that means the slope is 0. This is the onset of flow reversal. Any value of p lower than this, this curve is for p is equal to minus 2, then there is a flow reversal. Some part of the flow regime close to the stationary plate will flow in the opposite direction, while this part, the flow will be the positive direction. Now, we find out what is the volume flow rate. Volume flow rate is found out at any section. You can find out the volume flow rate like this, u dy 0 to h. Why? This is because you can think in this way, that you can take a small elemental area, this height is dy, and we consider the width to be unity. Then it is u dy integrated h, because dA will be dy into the width. Width is unity, or you can take some width b dy. B is the width in the z direction, which is very large, u b dy. So if you put the substitute the expression of u, u is what? U is u infinity into y by h plus p y by h into 1 minus y by h. If you put that, then you get an expression half, just you can solve it by putting this from 0 to h, half p by 6 u infinity into b into h. H will be there, that is very important. This is the flow rate. Just you substitute it and integrate it. And as you know that average velocity in fluid flow, in internal flow, average velocity is defined based on the volumetric flow rate. That means the average velocity across any section is volumetric flow divided by the cross-sectional area. Here cross-sectional area is same, which is equal to b into h, and therefore u average will be half. That means average velocity is nothing but the scale of volume flow rate. Scale is the cross-sectional area. Now here also another interesting scene is that when p is equal to minus 3, u average or is equal to q is equal to 0. Both u average is 0 and q 0. Rather, you should not write this way, u average equal to 0. Rather, simply q 0 and u average also 0. When p is equal to minus 3, what does it indicate? this is mathematics. That indicates what? That indicates again that negative value of P means adverse pressure gradient. P was defined as again H square. You see many a times we have written this U infinity minus dP dx. So P greater than, sorry, P is equal to minus 3 corresponds to a adverse pressure gradient with respect to H square mu U infinity. That means for a given channel, channel of given height with the fixed, the moving plate moving with a velocity U infinity with viscosity mu, if the pressure gradient is such that this satisfies this equation that dP dx is equal to H square by 2 mu infinity. That means if I write this, dP dx will be minus 3, that means 3 will be cancelled, 6 mu infinity by H square. That means this type of adverse pressure gradient will, I told that tug of war will arrest the flow. That means shear driven flow and pressure driven flow, because the adverse pressure gradient, that means pressure will drive the flow in this direction. Here you see, if you go on increasing the P, more region will be the flow reversal. And at that value of P minus 3, mathematically I see that you average 0. That means there is no net flow. Q is 0 across a section. That means there will be purely a circulatory flow. Some portion is negative, it goes up, positive, and comes down. So a locally recirculating flow will take place. And it will be 0. Okay? The average velocity will be 0. P is equal to minus 3. Any question? This figure, I think, before I leave you today, I will draw again so that you can very well understand the velocity distributions in a coed flow. Please wait. Please wait for 5 minutes. I will draw this figure very well, because in this diagram sometimes it is difficult. Let us consider this y by h, and let us here u by u infinity. Let us have two plates. P is equal to 0. That means dP dx 0. The velocity profile is like this. This is 1 and this is 1. This is very interesting. Let us have another situation where P is equal to P less than 1. P is some value. Let us consider P is 0.8, which corresponds to dP dx less than 0, because P is positive but less than 1. In that case, the picture is like this. This is 1, same u by u infinity. This scale is 1. The picture shows a nonlinear one like this. It doesn't have a maximum within the flow domain. So therefore, practically maximum velocity is attained at y by h is equal to 1. Y by h is equal to 1, which is nothing but the upper plate velocity, that is u infinity, that is 1. This is u by u infinity. This is u by u infinity. So here the maximum will attain somewhere outside. We are not interested. But P is equal to 1, when P is equal to, these are all favorable pressure gradient. P is equal to 1, greater than 0.8, and dP dx is obviously 0, then the difference is that the maximum velocity, sorry, The difference is that this is not linear, but the maximum velocity is attained at y by h1. The value is u infinity, but it is mathematical maxima. That means the value is u infinity, but it gives a mathematical maxima. So therefore, a physical difference between the two is there. From the functional value, there is no physical difference. Nobody bothers. Okay, you are u infinity maximum, but here mathematically maximum. Du dy is zero. So therefore, here there is a drag, but here drag is zero on the plate. No force is required to move the plate. And if you have more favorable pressure gradient, so that P becomes equal to, let this is 1, this is 0, and this is 1. So this will be 1, but there will be a velocity gradient like this. That means somewhere below the upper plate, there will be a velocity greater than u infinity. And then this decreases. And very interesting thing is that the velocity gradient changes its direction, because this is the decreasing part, which means physically that when you increase the favorable pressure gradient, then to keep the plate at u infinity, you have to push it in the opposite direction. Try to understand the physics, that there is a pool of liquid, you have a plate, no pressure gradient, you have to push the plate in a forward direction to make the flow in the same direction. Now you impose the pressure gradient, see the P, feel the pulse. At some pressure gradient, P is equal to 1, capital P, corresponding to that dP dx, negative value. You don't have to hold the plate. Plate will automatically move that u infinity. But if the pressure gradient increases more than that, then to keep the plate at that requisite velocity, you have to dP dx less than 0. We have to keep the pull the plate in the opposite direction to maintain the u infinity. You see from the figure, this is very clear. That's why I am drawing it separately. Okay, that is the beauty of the coed flow velocity variations with pressure gradient. Similarly, if we come to this direction, we will see that here at any pressure gradient, let us consider the negative value. P is equal to minus 0.5. dP dx is greater than 0. That means it is adverse. In that case, what happens? This is 1. This is 1. In that case, there is a linear, but no minimum, mathematical minimum. But minimum velocity is 0 velocity. No mathematical minimum. But minimum velocity, the functional value is 0 here, because that is the flow domain is truncated. But now, if I have a condition exactly at minus 1, just the mirror image of that, that means you can place a mirror here. Simple coed flow. This is simple or sometimes plain coed flow. Plain coed flow. So here you see, the difference is like this. They are mathematical minimum, which says the onset of flow reversal. Here there is no danger of flow reversal, but here there is a danger. Just after that, the flow reversal will take place. That means this is P is equal to minus 1. That means dP dx domain is less than 0. Sorry, greater than 0. Here P is equal to minus 2 and dP dx as usual, greater than 0. Here you see that already flow has separated. That means there is a flow reversal. That means if you show the figure like this, this is 0 and this is 1. Sorry, I am extremely sorry. Oh God. This is 0, this is 1.
this will be the clear. This is very important, but I spend more time in explaining the coet flow. Next class I will tell you the plain Poiseuille flow and Hagen Poiseuille flow. These are of the same kind. It will not take much time today. So exact solutions of Navier-Stokes equation is possible if the flow is, this is today's, what is the today's learning, if the flow is steady, incompressible, laminar and fully developed. And the solutions, final solution depends upon the flow geometry. But in this case, we can reduce the Navier-Stokes equation to a ordinary differential equations, linear ordinary differential equations by discarding the inertia terms, and we have only one single equation, because the essence is that flow velocity is not a function of the space coordinates along the flow, it is a function of the transverse coordinate. Another third coordinate by the definition of the geometry becomes absent, and pressure as a corollary of the y and z direction, two transverse coordinate direction Navier-Stokes equation gives us, is a linear function of the space coordinate along the direction of the flow. And accordingly it tells that u is a quadratic function of y. When you tell that d square u dy square is 1 by mu dp dx is constant, means p is a linear function of x and u is a quadratic function of y. For that you don't have to solve the equation, but you solve the equation, find the constants with the aid of the geometry of the flow. That will vary from coet flow to plain Poiseuille flow to Hagen Poiseuille flow. Okay, that is, these are the differences.